Good morning, everybody. On behalf of Pathfinders, I welcome you all to the 10th and the last episode of Bounce Back series. Thank you for joining us on a Saturday morning. The Bounce Back is a 10-part talk series where we, the Pathfinders, are discussing the challenges that our society have faced during the pandemic and how we have overcome them or in the process of overcoming them. We have been receiving feedback that the topics we have discussed so far have enriched people irrespective of the COVID situation. Let me introduce you to the Pathfinders. We are 5 coaches from different locations, different walks of life, and different specializations who have come together because of the common belief that with great power comes great responsibility. We believe that it is our imperative responsibility to contribute and make a difference. Let me start with Coach Mohammed Saeed. He is an MBA with over 3 decades of international work experience, a seasoned professional, an author, and a certified mind shift and empowering coach. Saeed is passionate about reaching out and actively engaged in guiding people to overcome their life challenges through mind shift and transformation. Coach Uzma Gulandaz. She is a certified ambition and unambiguity coach. She is extremely passionate about helping people with the issues that stand between them and their success. Being an English language trainer and a personality mentor, she also focuses on confidence and communication related matters. A postgraduate from London, she currently lives and works from the UAE. The Unblocked coach, Hemant Jain. He has been a coach, management consultant, and a trainer with over 18 years of corporate experience. He has worked with large organizations undergoing transformation, focusing on the people side of change. Many working professionals find themselves stuck within glass walls and glass ceilings. Through his coaching, Hemant helps them go higher and further in life and career. Coach Jyotika Shetty, she is a strategic life coach, international author, certified trainer, and an image consultant, helping people achieve their next level performance. She holds an MBA from Manchester Business School and has experience of over 20 years in corporate banking and entrepreneurship. Your host for the day, I am Arif Hussain. I'm a certified mindset and performance coach, an author, mentor, and a fitness enthusiast. A devoted family man who has been associated with the healthcare industry for about 2 decades. I guide working professionals between the age of 25 to 45 years to achieve their health and professional goals through mindset transformation. This is the 10th and last episode of the Bounce Back series. Topic for the day is Reach Out, importance of coaching. Now, let me tell you first what coaching is not. Coaching is not counseling, cure, or a therapy. Coaching is about helping you find who you really are, what you really want in life that is aligned with your inner self. Abraham Lincoln once said, the best way to predict your future is to create it. A coach helps you just do that. You get transformation to create future that you want. A coach can help make small changes in your life that not only look simple, but will have great impact on your life. My father was my first mentor. He tried to teach me a lot of life skills, provide good education, and help me get an all-round growth. I realized that I learned so many things from him, but not exactly all the ones he wanted me to learn or the way he wanted me to learn. Being a coach, it became one of the biggest realizations that the only person who could transform me is me. Same is true for you. Nobody can change you, but you can. As a coach, I will provide you the platform, the tools, the process, and the environment that will enable you to get transformation. People often ask me about the difference between coaching, counseling, mentoring, and consulting. While the communication used by these professionals looks similar, they use very different methodology, and it depends on what the client needs. For the audience, please type in the chat window, what is your understanding from coaching, mentoring, training, and counseling? And how do you think they differ from each other? Now, speaking about coaching, according to the International Coach Federation, coaching is defined as partnering with clients in a thought-provoking and creative process that inspires them to maximize their personal and professional potential. The coach is the subject matter at coaching and may or may not be the expert of subject matter of the client. Mentoring. A mentor is a wise and trusted guide and advisor. The mentor is the teacher that shares their experience to help in the growth of the mentee. Coaching is short-term, formal, structured, specific, and measurable, and it's performance-driven. While mentoring is about someone with seniority providing informal advice to someone less experienced. Mentoring is typically associated with developing co-workers. In most cases, experienced professionals who have seniority are paired with developing professionals. Now, then what is training? A training generally passes on knowledge and advice. This is primarily due to the trainer's expertise in that field. In many ways, it is similar to mentoring. The difference between training and mentoring is that mentoring is less formal and usually done one-to-one or in small groups. Whereas training, on the other hand, is usually more formal and generally done in larger groups. Training entails teaching because it passes on advice and knowledge. Now, what is consulting then? A consultant is an expert who is called on for professional or technical advice or opinions. They are supposed to provide solutions to a specific problem. While in coaching, the answers come usually from the client. Many aspects of coaching and counseling are overlapping, and therefore misconceptions are abundant. In general, counselors are trained to skillfully ask questions with the intention to diagnose and help clients with their problems, including emotional trauma, past events, or any dysfunction. It is for this reason that counselors generally require a license to practice, unlike others. The coach's domain is future-oriented. What does the client want? And then coaching the client to reach there. To understand more about coaching, let's talk to our panel of coaches. To start with, let me ask Coach Jyotika what she has to speak about coaching. Over to
you, Jyotika. Thank you. Thank you very much, Arif, and a very good morning to everyone present here today. Arif, thank you very much for that insightful introduction to what coaching is. And today I'm actually reminded of the wise words of Socrates, which says, know thyself. And that's pretty much what is the essence of what I'm going to say next. But before that, let me begin with a small story, an incident basically what happened recently. I was talking to a group of young adults, pretty much in their graduation and some were working. And I was talking to them about different things like that really matters to them, like success, career, all of those things. And at that time, when I was talking, a girl came up to me and said that I'm currently a media student and I really do not resonate with what I'm doing. I just don't like it and I do not know what to do. So I asked her, why is that you feel so? She had absolutely no idea. She could not answer a why. Obviously, I'm not a career counselor. So I said, I don't have an answer for your career, your question as to what you should be doing in the future. But there are a few insights that I can give as to why are you feeling the way you're feeling. But actually looking at it, isn't this the case with most of us, that we are either not happy with what we are doing or confused thinking what to do in life? While many claim that they know their passion, in the same sentence, they will also say that it is not the right time for them to pursue their passion. Probably because they think that their passion is not reasonable enough to get food on the table. And thus leaving them eternally confused and not taking a call on what to do with their passion and thus regretting not doing what they always wanted to do. But the question is, how will you know what is the right thing for you? But my question is, do you really think it is easy to answer this question without knowing what you want in life? But the only way to know what you want to know in what you want in life is to first know who you are. Knowing yourself is not about skimming the surface, like finding your favorite color or music you like, although it might give you some cues. Knowing yourself is about delving much deeper into who you are. In my life, I've come across many engineers, including my husband, who eternally keep saying that they became engineers because their parents wanted them to become. And they're really not happy doing what they're doing. And they want to actually do something else. We also hear people saying that interpersonal skill is very important because ultimately your success depends on how you interact with people, how you reach out to people and all of this. But I would like to ask you a question. While relationship with others is important, on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you like to rate your relationship with yourself? I wouldn't be surprised if you rate it 7, 8, or even 10, because that's what people would like to believe. But again, let me ask you a question. When was the last time you looked at yourself in the mirror and asked, what is it I want in this life? This would be a tough question. Sometimes we wonder, what is it we really want? And we don't have an answer to this question. There could be things like, what is the best career for me? Who is the best partner? Where should I live? What should I do? And all of these things. But knowing yourself is a journey on its own. It is about discovering who you are as a human being. The journey brings you face to face with your deepest fears, self-doubts, vulnerabilities, and insecurities. On the journey, you question, along the journey, you question how you are living your life and whether or not it is in alignment with your highest purpose. And most of the time, people get confused between what is their highest purpose. But purpose is not something that you learn overnight. It's a journey on its own. So if you do not know your highest purpose yet, you could try out reaching to someone else who could probably ask you those questions, give you some enlightenment, which will lead you towards a direction which could probably help you discover your purpose. Knowing yourself is also being aware of your core values, priorities, and dreams, even if you do not know them yet. It also means respecting your strengths, your weaknesses, your passion, fears, your desires and dreams, your thoughts and feelings, your likes and dislikes, your tolerances and limitations. Because we are often too hard on ourselves, isn't it? Now, the girl who mentioned to me that she was not happy about what she was doing, probably if she had an awareness of who she was, her decision of what she wanted to do in life could have been better and she would have had better clarity. While knowing yourself is a priority process on its own, you can start with an effective tool. It's a very simple tool, but effective tool called as a Johari window. This tool is available freely online and you can always go and refer to it. The technique helps you to understand how you perceive yourself and how others perceive you. Because the first thing to knowing yourself is also understanding how you think about yourself, how you perceive and how others perceive. So that also helps you to build relationship with yourself. Now, you know, sometimes you may have felt that the world thinks of you in a certain way and you do not know, you've not done anything to them, yet you feel that there is something that is not going right. You have uncomfortable association with another person, you've not done anything, but why is it happening so? Why are they thinking that there is something wrong with you? You may wonder what is wrong with you and your relationship also could falter. Now imagine this happening in a professional environment. Definitely it could hinder your progress, isn't it? Also, you may end up having wrong perception about your own self, which we call as, you know, your own negative codes. Johari window will give you the clarity on what are the areas that you want to work on. It simply is based on the fact that trust can be acquired by revealing information about you to others and learning yourselves from their feedback. In a nutshell, I would like to emphasize on the importance of understanding who you are, because this is what will help you make better decisions in life and also gain momentum towards success. This will also avoid you not eternally compromising on things, but creating a path that will lead towards sustainable growth. Over to you, Arif.
Thank you, Jyotika, for sharing the importance of understanding the inner self, that is knowing yourself. Knowing who you are is the beginning of where you want to reach. So let me ask Coach Jyotika, what should be the next step in that journey of transformation that a person may be looking for? And what limits people in reaching where they want to reach? Coach Usma. Well,
you meant first, Usma, right?
Hi, everyone. I hope you're all safe and well. And before I begin, I would like you all to see something. And no, I did not mean Jyotika. It's a video. So, did you ever ask yourself before carrying out an important task? Give me a second, please. Did you ever ask, do you ever ask these questions for yourself before you do something important? Will I be able to do it? Or am I going to mess this up? Or do you say to yourself, I will not be able to make it, or even I'm the best person for this task? In short, questions or statements that either lead to self-doubt, as in, am I good enough? Or absolute self-assurance that makes you think I am the best. These thoughts work like a background score in your important moments, pretty much like the Careless Whisper song that was being played over the Bruce Lee video that we just watched, changing the whole tone, mood of how you feel about the task and yourself in your inside world. This is what is called the inner voice. It's inside your head, your mind, and though no one else can hear it, it's the loudest sound for your ears and confidence level. You cannot shut it out, neither can you run away from it, because it is very deeply ingrained in you. We'll come to the inner voice telling you positive things in a minute. But first, let us understand how the negative thoughts in your mind affect you and shape the outcome of whatever you are putting your efforts into. Now, let me tell you, not all of those not so good thoughts are ours. A lot of these are actually acquired by us from the people around us, especially during our crucial moments all along our early life. In other words, childhood, also during our teenage years when we begin to develop in more than one way. This is why they are called formative years. It could be our parents, extended family, or even peers. Now, this is not to say that we have no accountability in this whole process, because we do. This is also not to say that we have to hate anyone who may have contributed to those thoughts in our mind, because they too may have experienced the same treatment, and that means they didn't know any better. These instances have a lasting effect on the person who experiences them, and the underlying feelings of inadequacy that develop in such a person hold him or her back from being their best. These are played over and over again in our mind like a rap song set on a continuous loop. This is where a coach comes into the picture. A coach will not only help you to recognize the reasons and sources of those internal emotions that you hold back, but will also help you to get out of that rap track to be your best version. Coaching seems to be a newer concept in certain parts of the world, but it has been used by professional sportsmen from all over the world to improve their game. No, I'm not talking about the coaches that help with the technicalities of the game. I'm talking about the various forms of life coaches that work with the mind and attitude of the athlete to make them their ultimate self. I know I'm addressing an audience that usually consists of cricket fans, or so I assume. I ask you to look into the experts that the teams hire besides the specialists that help with the actual game. Now, how important is having the right mindset? Well, very, very. Do you remember watching cricket in the 90s? Well, yes, I'm giving an example of cricket because, like I said, I think most of the audiences here are cricket fans. Australia has been a strong contender in the sport for a long, long time. And besides their excellent great game strategy in all aspects, they were known for another very effective strategy, sledging. What do you think that was? It was a mind game that allowed the Australian team to target the confidence and concentration of their opponents, break them down from the innermost place, and instill this peculiar nervousness in the mind of the concerned batsman or bowler. Most fell prey to this tactic, and the few who didn't either faced the sledging with equal retaliation or kept themselves calm and allowed only their game to speak on their behalf. This is why they say it's all a case of mind over matter. Now, the scenario of the positive inner thoughts brings to my mind the name of Muhammad Ali, the late great boxer who said he always thought of himself as a great athlete. He kept repeating his positive thoughts to himself and was also, of course, obsessed with training. He knew how essential it was to be in that frame of mind. All of this is true, not only for sportsmen, but also for businessmen, industrialists, and you name them. Even actors work with life coaches to enrich their mind, improve their performance, and become their ultimate self. Self-development and mental health are important. So when it comes to your mind, your inner self, asking for help is not an approach you should rule out. Instead, reach out. Back to you, Arif.
Thank you, Coach Uzma, for sharing how important it is to understand your belief system and, more importantly, your limiting ones. So it also reminds me of Muhammad Ali, the great boxer, how he used to convert his beliefs into by telling himself that he's the greatest, I'm the greatest, I'm the greatest. And he said that until others starting telling the same. Now I want to ask Coach Saeed, how does one's inner self and belief system affect different areas of life? What do you have to say about it, Saeed?
Thank you, Hemant. You are in a very commendable position. You control everybody's voice. Thank you, Arif. Yeah. All my previous speakers who have said things, especially what Kuzma was saying about having a coach. We all presume that we know ourselves, like what Jyotika has said and what you all said. Now, I would like to ask the audience here, how many out there can confidently say that I know what's going on in my life? Because usually we presume that we are in control or we are in command. I think this is one of the biggest misconceptions that we all have about ourselves, that we think we know how things are. We spend years, maybe 16 to 20 years of life, taking degrees, studying subjects, even studying psychology, trying to know people, how people think, how they behave. While we have never made any conscious effort to know about ourselves, what's going on in our life. Suppose a person has a strong physique, but can't see properly. So what's the result? Result is that he will not be able to function well in spite of all his good health. So it's not possible, so are the various other aspects of life. If a person could perform very well and is successful professionally, let's say, but neglects his health, so all his earnings and all his wealth is of no use because he's not able to function well. Can this approach work in the long run? No. So eventually, the areas where he's not doing well are going to affect the overall performance and pull him down. So while it is quite ambiguous as to where we stand with all critical areas of life, let me generally mention the areas that are critical in our lives. Like if you take health, wealth, career, relationships, friends, family, recreation, or maybe personal development. These are kind of considered as vital for people. We all strive to achieve these things in our lives. However, what we end up doing is that we focus on one or a couple of things, which in most cases, either it's career, you go after a job, after promotion, after things like that. And you go after making money, wealth, buying this, buying material things. And in most cases, people do succeed. People do succeed by working hard. They achieve these things. However, there is every possibility that some areas get neglected. And in most cases, the sacrificing goat is here, either it is your family or your personal health, or in a worst scenario, both of them. So we often talk about work-life balance, but we never discuss our own balance, that balance that we need to have. So what is that balance I'm talking about? Let me try to show you in a pictographic manner that people can understand. So this is what in a coaching language called a wheel of life. If, can I have a picture on that? So wheel, when I say a wheel, generally, what is the first thing that comes to your mind? Something round, something in circle, something that rolls out easily. So when we put all our areas of life into this in it, sections and see where we stand with each of them, if we are good in all of them, it would obviously form a perfect wheel, which denotes that you have a smooth life or you have going well, you have all things going well for you and life is going smooth. But when you have some areas you are doing well and some areas you are not doing well, what the picture is showing you is basically it has formed a jagged wheel, something imperfect. So what is imperfect doesn't move perfectly. So a jagged wheel cannot move smooth. So your life is supposed to be something like a bumpy road. So ideally, if all areas are doing good, it's like you're having a smooth life. So when we miss on some of these, the importance to take holistic view of life, we end up having this kind of some areas missing or some areas doing short and someone is doing good. So we need to strive to build a holistic life because all the areas are basically interdependent. They affect each other. So compromising on one will eventually lead you to compromising on the whole system because one can pull down the whole thing. The best part of human being is that it is never too late to start. People can, I mean, especially I'm talking about people who are in their 50s or so, they kind of reach a mental state where they say kind of they give up or they accept whatever is the situation, saying that either call it fate or either call it luck or whatever it is. And they kind of adjust themselves to live with that imbalance rather than try to achieve a holistic life. But this can be achieved at any age, at any time. The sooner the better, of course. So what we can do to achieve this holistic life? First is to get a clear picture of where you stand with each area of your life. Make a self-evaluation or take help to do that. Realize the critical areas where some extra effort is required. Improve the areas that are lagging behind and continue with what doing well. Work in parallel in all the areas so you move and grow in every area in such a way that a holistic development and a completeness is achieved. At times, this is a difficult thing to do all by yourself. This is difficult to achieve by others. So realize that it is perfectly okay to seek help, to ask somebody, to approach somebody. Like you see, even like my previous speakers who I mentioned, even the big people, the successful people, like, you know, nobody need to tell Virat Kohli how to hold a bat, but still he will have a coach. Like I remember Andre Agassi, when he was at the top, he was still seeing Tony Robbins to coach him mentally to be strong, to fight his games. So this is how it goes. You are doing well or you in one area and you're not good in some area, your ego or your sense of shame need not stop you from seeking help because it is perfectly okay to seek help and become better because once you become better, it is your own life which is becoming better and you in turn can make others better. But if instead, if you hide it and try to suppress it or try to hide it from others, what I end up seeing is that you are incomplete. Your incompleteness also reflects to your immediate people around you. So it is always better you open up and talk to somebody you trust or somebody whom you have confidence on. So life will present its opportunities always. However, we will not be able to take advantage of it unless we decide to step out of our self-deceiving comfort zone, experience the transformation, and take charge of our life. That's it. Over to you, Arif.
Thank you, Coach Saeed, for enlightening us. you reminded me of the jagged wheel that I had and why my life at times was that bumpy ride, right? But you also reminded me about those Andre Agassi's matches in the later part of his career when he was a completely changed person. And I can remember those matches when he was like, he never gave up even playing with the top of the players who were at the top at the time. And he was one of the eldest person during that period. And that coaching with Tony Robbins actually changed him completely. Now my question to audience is, now, do you ever feel that you need help from somebody outside? And for what? And let me move to Coach Hemant. My question is, why do we actually require coaching? And what does a coach do and how?
Thank you, Coach Arif. Okay, is there an echo here? Okay.
No, it's okay.
Great. So let me talk about a couple of things. Every year we invest our time and energy into something called New Year resolutions. Some of us also do a bit of goal setting. Some of us who have been a part of the corporate world, we have this annual cycle where we sit with our managers and do our goal setting exercise. Some of us also create our own personal goals which we want to achieve. Now, whether we call them goals, New Year resolutions, or our targets, we are putting our time, energy, and effort into achieving certain things. And then we do. For some of those goals, we are consistent for months. For some, just about weeks. Some, we probably give up in a few days, like the gym visits. After the membership is taken and we have seen the gym, I think after that, the novelty dies out. So depending on how emotionally connected we are, how passionate we are about that particular goal or the resolution, there is either a sense of achievement, we achieve that goal over a period of time, or some of the goals we kind of either give up or we are having a partial achievement. And that is what makes the difference, that passion and that alignment of the goal with our inner self. Coach Jyotika talked about knowing yourself first. That's the foundation. Knowing yourself and aligning your goals to your inner thoughts, inner voice, and who you are is extremely important if you want to have any chance of achieving those goals. Look back at all those goals which you have not achieved, and you will find somewhere the disconnect between yourself and the goals as kind of a reason for not achieving those goals. Same goes for decision making also. We make a lot of decisions in life, and when we look back at them in retrospect, we are thinking of them as good decisions, bad decisions, decisions which made us happy and which did not make us happy. Again, that internal alignment between the decision and who we are emotionally, is what matters. Without that emotional connect and that alignment, even the decisions won't make us happy. For a moment, going back to this goals, we often hear about SMART goals, the specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time-bound goals which everybody advocates. What I have been talking about is making those goals smarter. Beyond that SMART, add a little bit of ER, which is your emotional resonance with your SMART goals. Add that little bit of spice of ER, and your smarter goals will be easier to achieve. Most of us in the audience, and I mean, barring one or two members, we would have gone through life and come to a stage where we have anywhere in between 10 to 20 years of experience, maybe even 30 years of experience. And we are at a point where we have either reached a level beyond which we don't see any growth, or we have remained in a particular position for an extended period of time. And life has begun to stagnate. There are times when we feel there is no further purpose. There are times when we feel, what am I doing here? We feel stuck. We have always heard about glass ceilings. I also refer to them as glass walls, because we feel stuck not only in terms of our upward movement, but we are unable to look for opportunities beyond the current place we are in another zone, in another industry, in another area of life. Now, this is where understanding ourselves, our vision, our goal in life is important. Now, this is where I bring in the coach. The coach can help you align your goals to yourself. The coach can guide you by asking questions to you, where leading you to the right decisions. The coach can help you explore what is there out there beyond your current glass walls. Your current glass walls are frosted. The coach will help you clean them up so you can see through them and even break through them. Remember, today our phones have got GPS and Google Maps, which help us find our way. Your coach is not your Google Maps. The coach will not give you the path to follow. The coach is the GPS. The coach tells you where you are and also helps you discover where you want to be. And then you become your own Google Maps. The coach will help you become your Google Maps. The coach will help you find and define your own path. Arif, that's what a coach does. The coach will not give you answers. He'll get the answers from you. He'll take you to a place where you can create your own answers. That's what a coach does. Over to you.
Thanks, Coach Hemant, for clearly defining the role of a coach in one's life and what change can a coach bring. Now we know how important it is to know who you are from within, how your beliefs limit you or pull you down, what the impact of these things in all areas of life, and what can a coach do to change, either aligning your goals to who you are or vice versa. So after knowing all these things, the question arises, who is the right coach for you? So if you ask these three questions to yourself, you'll get to know if the coach you are pursuing is the right one for you. The number one is, has the coach achieved results that I want to achieve either for himself or for others? So if I want to get healthier, I have to look for if the coach himself is healthy or he or she has helped people achieve those results before. I would go to a coach who is talking from experience rather than some theory. The second question you should ask is the coach authentic? How do you find it? Look for his content, his books, there are details on website. If possible, talk to him or her. Who is he following for his own guidance? Just ask him if you can't find. You'll get to know, you'll get the vibe if he's authentic or not. The third question you should ask is the coach accessible? Are you only supposed to get the transformation through watching his or her videos, or it's going to be a proper handholding? Is the coach ready to take accountability of your actions or provide somebody as your accountability partner? Now, we were talking about Tony Robbins creating and changing others' lives. But Tony Robbins is one of the most renowned coaches, but he himself had a coach at one point of life. That was Jim Rohn. Virat Kohli, we were talking about Virat Kohli being one of the best batsmen. Yet, he has a coach. Same is true with leaders like Barack Obama or Bill Clinton and many more great leaders. You can check for your own CEOs or people who are highly successful that you know. They all have been coached and handheld by somebody as and when required. We all need handholding to grow in life or just to save those precious years from struggle. A coach keeps you disciplined, accountable for your actions, and keeps you working relentlessly towards your goals. Many people isolate themselves, think unkindly of themselves, and blame others too for their problems. They do not reach out for help and prefer to suffer in silence. My question to you is, are you the ones who reach out to others for help, or are you the ones who think they know everything and have lonely battle throughout life. But before we open the floor for discussion, we have some exciting news to share with all of you. Hemant, can you share? Okay, so this Bounce Back series was a 10-episode talk show that we started, you know, 10 weeks ago. So this is the last episode today that we have. So all five of our five coaches of Pathfinders, we decided to convert or to create a book on the same topic, that is Bounce Back. And we are going to launch the book on 5th of September, 2021. So you are the first group of people who have, you know, who can see the cover page of the book. So now the floor is open for discussions. So anybody, if anybody has any questions or would like to speak something, the floor is open. You just have to raise hand, maybe in the reactions in your window or, yeah, Aruna ji, I can see you.
Yeah, congratulations all of you, first and the foremost. I love this news that you have broken just now, and wonderful. And keep soaring high, keep going further, keep achieving more milestones. That is what I would like to say.
Thank you.
Thank Aruna
you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Arif.
Yeah. Hi, Manshu.
Yeah. Yeah, big congratulations to all of you. This was really a good surprise. I mean, it was so exciting to see this thing. And I will look forward to this book. And I've always given this feedback to all of you that this was really a wonderful initiative. All the topics were, extremely insightful, and something special was there in each session. So I believe such initiatives should keep continue, and we'll surely wait for your next season to come to see some more exciting topics and to touch some areas of such areas which were not touched before, and I look forward. So thank you once again. It was really nice to see you all on every Saturdays and to have such learnings from you all, from your experiences. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Himanshu.
Thank you, Himanshu.
Thank you, Himanshu. Probably you were one of the people who were there in almost all the episodes. And, this love actually carried us to, this 10th episode, and we are actually thinking of getting more seasons. So you'll have other news as well in the coming times.
I'm confident more very soon we'll be touching that century. I'm very confident for that.
Thank you. It is support from people like you, Himanshu, that are able to do things what we do. Because without the support of our well-wishers, there's very little that we can do. So thank you for being with us in this journey.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Yeah. No, I think...
Yeah, Saeed, you were saying something. I think we will have to... Then only you will be able to speak.
Two devices. That's the echo. Sirat and Rajshri, can you come on video? We could take a picture. Yes.
Okay.
What I was trying to say is that there are a few people who are with our journey right from beginning till today. And we are really thankful to all those people who were always present, who gave us encouraging words, and brought us to up to this now. And with your support, yes, we hope to go long way ahead. And thanks for your support.
So obviously, please do attend the book launch, which is on 5th of September, which is a Teacher's Day. And please do attend, as we plan to launch it with a bit of, you know, celebration. So let's make it great. Obviously, we'll let you know. We'll send you an invite. Please be there.
Rajshri, any thoughts from your end?
Rajshri, we are seeing for the first time here.
Yeah, I saw Syed. I saw the message, but I missed it out. Love the view, and I was down with COVID and all, so just recovered from it. Yeah, so I was not in touch.
You are a fighter. You are an internal fighter.
Yeah, and circumstance dictates. I am willingly not becoming a fighter.
You're an absolute fighter. How that?
I was actually planning to be in touch, and anyway, I'm happy today, even though it is at the later part of the event. I said, no, let me just join and meet you guys.
Thanks for talking.
Hi, Rajshri. And hope you are good now.
Yeah, I am perfectly all right. Thank you, Arif.
Thank you. Sirat, we can't see you.
Sorry,
I was just referring to. Yeah, thank you for coming. I was saying, Sirat, we can't see. That's the only face missing from our panel right now. Everybody we can see except Sirat.
Yeah, Uzma was saying something.
Yes.
I was just saying thank you for dropping in, Rajshri. I mean, hope you're feeling well now.
I'm better, much better.
So would you like to shed some light on today's topic, coaching?
Jyoti, give me a day. Let me get back. I just wanted to get back into the thing. It's been completely out of touch. It's been very bad for me. Yeah, I just got well maybe a week back. And then I had an accident, and I just, so it was like, I'm still in that shock. I'm not completely out, but I said, let me get in touch with you guys. Then, you know, it gives me back a feel that yes, I'm with the family. You know, otherwise I feel so lost when I'm not in touch with this. So I said, today if you ask me to contribute, I think I'll be a little lost. Give me a day or
no
two.
Worries.
Next session, I will surely.
Yes. Take care, Rajshri.
Sirat and Arunaji, if you want to share something about coaching, so you can share actually.
Okay. Right. As all of you had been saying, that you need to really look at what kind of a problem you want to be addressing. And exactly not a problem also. The way you want to project yourself and the way you want to grow yourself. Because it's not always that a coach is addressing only a problem. It is how to gain your next level and how to go to the next episode of your life. I think you need somebody who can handhold you and take you to that place. So I don't look at a coach, you know, as a shoulder to cry upon. He is a person whom you hold on to so that you can move ahead in life. I would like to put it that way, because I don't want to see crying faces at all. That's one thing I never like to see. So if you put it like this, yes, a coach is there who is your mentor, who is your dear one, with whom you can actually 100% rely upon, that he or she is the person who can be trusted upon, basically. And that is the first thing I think a coach has to develop with whomever he wants to work with. The first thing is the trust. And I think the rest of the things will fall in place once that is developed. So you don't have to be very quick in starting your coaching or starting giving the tips. I think the first thing is develop the trust, take your time, and then move ahead. That is what my belief has been. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Runaji. And that's very important thing, building the trust. And of course, we are more comfortable to reach out to people who we can trust. And that's why, when we discussed, we spoke about being authentic. So if you can feel that the person is authentic, you can reach out to them. So with this, if there is any question, we can take those questions or we can close it now. All right. Thank you everyone for joining in. And we really appreciate your presence here. The session is closed now officially, so we can stop the recording.